Hey, 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 First Baptist Fort Lauderdale, how you doing this morning? Somebody make some noise for Jesus in this place. Man, you look good. Look at somebody you're sitting next to and tell them, you look good today. Gave some guy an opportunity just now. Man, you guys look good. You guys worshiping good too. Does anybody love the worship here at First Baptist Church? The worship team does an exceptional job. For those that may not know who I am, my name is Pastor Charlie Hughes. I have the privilege of leading the young adult movement here at First Baptist Church called Rally. Do I have any young adults in the building? Can you make some noise, young adults? I love you so, so much. For those that may not know, Rally is the young adult movement of this church, but one of the main things we do is a monthly service. And we had our monthly service, not this past Friday, but the Friday before here in this room. And let me tell you, God is doing something. We had 700 young adults in this room on a Friday night worshiping King Jesus. Let me give you some perspective. This room only sits 600 people. We had 700 young adults in this building. Somebody give Jesus some praise in this place. So on behalf of all the young adults of this church, let me say thank you to those who empower us to do what we do and chase after King Jesus. It means the world to us. Some may have heard, today is my 24th birthday. And my dad is the senior pastor of this church. He's at our sister church, Church by the Glaze, right now preaching. And you might be thinking, man, does this guy's dad not love him? Like, why'd he make him preach on his birthday? No, I asked to be here because I want to spend my birthday partying with First Baptist Church. So do I have any party animals in the building who are going to help me preach? I don't want to preach alone on my birthday. Don't make me preach by myself. Thank you. Thank you. I don't know about you, but like birthdays make me like sentimental and make me want to take a trip down memory lane. So this morning I've been thinking a little bit about my last 24 years of life, and I've been thinking about how God has blessed me with great parents. I love my mom and dad. And something my dad specifically did really well, I think, just as a parent with me and my siblings growing up, was every single night he'd watch TV with us. It was just kind of our thing. He'd always watch one of our shows, but because it was my dad and not my mom who mainly watched TV with us every night, we did also watch our fair share of action films. Does anybody love the action genre in film? So if you're like me and over the course of your life, you've watched a few hundred action movies, my guess is you've seen a scene in an action movie at least a few times where there's this fight at the very end between a good guy and a bad guy, and the bad guy has the good guy in a position that isn't looking too good for the good guy, and the bad guy asks the good guy, any last words? To which the good guy will say something super cool and epic, and, you know, of course, the tables will turn, and the good guy in the end will start to win. But I don't know, maybe I'm just super self-consumed and self-absorbed, but I always think to myself in that moment, if I was the good guy in that position, what would I say? Like, there's enough pressure in that moment on the good guy already. He's fighting for his life. But to add the pressure of making a sentence, putting a sentence together, saying the last few words that count, like, that's a lot of pressure. And I'd like to lie to myself and tell myself that I would say something very profound or deep or quote a Bible verse. But really, I think I would just be like, please don't kill me. Last words, they matter. On a mountaintop, in Galilee, following his crucifixion, after his resurrection, right before his ascension into heaven, Jesus gave his 11 remaining disciples a story to tell, a message to spread, an assignment to accomplish, a function to fulfill, a commission to carry. Jesus' last words are found in Matthew chapter 28. He made the most of them. They are famously known as the Great Commission. And they read this, starting in verse 16. Then the 11 remaining disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, with all authority in heaven and on earth that has been given to me, I tell you, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. And surely, surely I'm with you always to the very end of the age. It is not an overstatement, an exaggeration, or a dramatization of the text to say that these five verses, these 95 words, this mission, this command is the focus and focal point of all of Scripture. The entire Bible is centered around this command of Christ to go and make disciples. This mission is what the Old Testament points to. This mission is what the Gospels prioritize. This mission is what the rest of the New Testament exemplifies. And although this mission is clearly given to these 11 remaining disciples, make no mistake about it, it is for you and I as well. We may not have been on that mountaintop 2,000 years ago, but First Baptist Church, don't get it twisted. This commission is also ours to carry. Jesus gave this mission to these men with you and I in mind. So despite what your discomfort may be telling you, and despite what you may want to believe, Jesus was not giving you an option when he gave you this mission. Jesus did not say, go and make disciples if you feel like it. Jesus did not say, go and change the world if you can fit it into your busy schedule. Jesus did not say, go tell everyone you know about me if you're cool and comfortable with that. No. But with all authority that he had been given in heaven and on earth, Jesus gave us the clear and uncompromising command to go and make disciples. Oh, if you're under the sound of my voice this morning, and you would call yourself a Christian, if you would identify as a follower of Jesus, if you're here and you would affirm that Jesus is the Son of God, that he is the prophesied Messiah, that he came 2,000 years ago, lived 33 years of a perfect life, during which he never once sinned, never once made a mistake, never once committed any type of wrongdoing, only to then die on a cross on our behalf and raise from the dead 3 days later, so that way you and I can live forever, then you should feel the weight of this mission. This mission should inspire you. It should impact you. It should light a fire within you and influence every aspect of who you are, how you live, and how you love others. Because this mission is not the great suggestion. It's the great commission. So if we're truly followers of Jesus, then it is our responsibility to make Jesus' last words our first priority. The title of this sermon is Get Your Priorities Straight. Look at somebody you're sitting next to and tell them the title of this sermon with some attitude like you mean it. Tell them, get your priorities straight. Some of you are having a little bit too much fun with that. Jesus is very clear in his commissioning, but I would also argue that the context in which he commissions is very revealing. As we've already observed, Jesus gave this mission to these men on a mountaintop in Galilee after his crucifixion, following his resurrection, right before his ascension into heaven. Meaning, by this point in the story, these 11 disciples have already witnessed Jesus be brutally beaten, publicly humiliated, wrongly convicted, falsely accused, and die a criminal's death on a cross. And although by now Jesus has obviously, miraculously risen from the dead and appeared to them, I don't know if you caught it, but verse 17 gave us the beautiful biblical detail that some of these disciples were still having a hard time believing what their eyes were now seeing. They were doubting. And I mean, can you really blame them? Because the images of what they would have witnessed Jesus endure on the cross would have still been so fresh and present in their minds. This is my fake mountain in Galilee. So I have to think that every step these men would have taken up this mountain would have been accompanied with so much confusion, with so much skepticism, with so much doubt. These men must have been thinking to themselves and saying to each other, are we sure we aren't crazy? Are we sure we saw who we thought we saw? Are we sure that was Jesus who told us to meet him on this mountain? Are we sure that we aren't delusional as a result of our grief? Are we sure that when we finally make it to the top of this mountain, that we aren't going to be just as confused and just as heartbroken and just as sad as we were only a few days ago when our rabbi died on that cross at Golgotha? But yet, despite their doubt, they pressed on. And it was at this time, in this place, when Jesus chose to finally give these men their mission. How interesting. Jesus spent 3 years with these dudes. He could have chose to give them their mission at any point in time during the 3 years he spent with them. But yet, in climactic fashion, Jesus chose the last time he'd ever be physically present with them to give them their mission, to emphasize the necessity, the urgency, and the importance of the mission he was leaving them with. I also have to think that by receiving this mission on this mountaintop would have caused this mission to resonate differently in the hearts and minds of these 11 disciples, because Galilee was known as Galilee of the Gentiles. For those that don't know, the term Gentile is a term that is used to describe someone who is not a follower or believer in the one true God. So by receiving this mission on this mountaintop, overlooking the city of Galilee, these 11 disciples would have immediately and intuitively understood and recognized to where, to who God was calling them to. From this elevated perspective, these disciples had to have understood that they were positioned for the mission. And I love the Bible. If you skip ahead to the book of Acts chapter 1, few books in the Bible to your right, the story continues. Although these men probably would have understood their mission intuitively, God left no room for confusion. And it tells us in Acts chapter 1 that after Jesus gave them this mission and Jesus was ascending into heaven, that they, the disciples, were looking intently up into the sky as Jesus was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white, most likely angels, stood beside them and said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven." These angels were essentially saying to these disciples, "What are you still doing here? You've been given your mission. You've been given your marching orders. Now move." And I think it's really easy for us as a modern day 21st century audience sitting in this air conditioned building at sea level to want to mock and make fun and laugh at these 11 remaining disciples on this mountaintop 2,000 years ago, when really, some of us aren't ones to talk. Because if you be honest, in your heart of hearts, you know the mission God has given you. You know where God has called you to go. You know what God has called you to do. You know who in your life you need to invite to join you here at First Baptist Church for Easter. But yet still here you sit on your metaphorical mountaintop, looking intently up into the sky, waiting for something to happen, and God is waiting on you to move. Every mountaintop moment will leave you with a mission that will require your movement. You must move out of your comfort zone. You must move out of your shell. You must move out of your safe and certain Christian circles where others like you, know you, accept you. You must move and risk it all so that way someone else may potentially gain everything. You must move to spread the message. You must move to tell the story. You must move to accomplish the assignment. You must move to fulfill the function. You must move to correctly carry this commission. You must move. The first word in this command is go. Safe to say, you cannot make disciples by staying where you are. You must move because you possess a truth that is too good to keep to yourself. You've got to move. Somebody say, move. But maybe you're here and you're like, "Charlie, okay, but how? I'm a practical person. What steps do I need to take? What instructions do I need to follow? Even this language, make disciples, seems a little abstract, seems a little ambiguous. Where do I go from here? I'm glad you asked. I can understand. I would consider myself a resourceful person, but I also don't appreciate when someone tells me or asks me to do something that I've never done before and then gives me no idea of how to do it. This is why if I find myself in this position, one of the first things I'll do is I'll try to find someone who's more experienced and more accomplished in what I've been asked to do than I am, whose example I can follow. Lucky for you, if you're here and you're a follower of Jesus, you have the greatest teacher for making disciples that there is. His name is Professor Jesus. Not only does Jesus command us to make disciples, but Jesus is the truest and most complete example of how to make disciples that there is. When I think about the life and ministry of Jesus, I can't help but notice that Jesus was a fearless and relentless inviter. Oh, Jesus was bold in his invitation, both in who he chose to invite and how he chose to invite them. Making disciples starts by making bold invitations. Just think about these 11 men on this mountaintop when Jesus recruited them to join his ministry 3 years earlier. Jesus did not wait for these men to come to him. Jesus went to them. Jesus straight up asked these men to leave behind their friends, their families, their jobs, their successful businesses, all they knew, had, and loved, to come and follow him. If that's not bold, I don't know what is. Which makes me think, isn't it crazy how we will say no to the invitations we know we need to make to people in our lives for them before we ever invite them and give them a chance to respond for themselves? Oh, don't look at me like that. You know we do this. We do this by making excuses for them before we ever even invite them. Oh, they look busy. I know they got a lot going on. They're going to have family in town. Their kids are young. They've probably already made plans. I don't want to create an awkward situation. I don't want to waste their time. I don't want to waste my time. So I'm not going to invite them. I'm sure they can't even make it. Listen, this is bad grammar, but it's good theology. Jesus never said no for nobody. We got to check our hearts. Stop making excuses and start making bold invitations. If Jesus did not wait for people to come to him, then we cannot wait for people to come to us. We've got to be bold enough to make the first move. Sometimes I think us Christian people treat inviting our friends to church like how dysfunctional single people treat dating. Let me play hard to get. Let me not show too much interest too soon. Let me wait for them to come to me. While secure single people understand that if they put themselves out there and get rejected, this is not a reflection of their value or an assault on their character. It just means that whoever they put themselves out there to was not in a position or headspace to understand and recognize what an amazing opportunity they just turned down. So we show them love, we extend them mercy, and we move on to the next. So are there any single people I'm preaching to in this place? First Baptist Church, we've got to stop being so afraid of rejection, and we got to stop taking no so personally. If Jesus did not wait for people to come to him, then we can't wait for people to come to us. This is not about playing hard to get. This is about putting ourselves out there, keeping no secrets, showing all of our cards from the jump, and making bold invitations. If we're going to have any shot at changing this world, if we're going to have any shot at reaching this city, if we're going to have any shot at making disciples and introducing our friends to our Creator and Savior, then we must be bold enough to make the first move. We got to make the first move. Make the first move. Let me tell you, Jesus That brother knew how to make the first move. Jesus had no problem making an attractive invitation because Jesus committed his life to what he described as the two most important commandments, loving God and loving others. Yes, our invitations must be bold, but above all else, our invitations must be loving. And I'd actually argue that by inviting your friends to church to join you here for Easter at First Baptist Church, I mean, we're opening up that amazing room that's been closed because we've been doing construction on it. I'm telling you, it's the nicest room on the East Coast as far as churches go. It's going to be insane. But I think this is the greatest act of love, inviting your friends to church, that you can show your friends and show God, because there are a few greater acts of love than obedience that disagrees with your comfort. So that shows God that you love him by honoring his command to go and make disciples. But I think inviting your friends to church shows your friends that you love them, because I have to think, even if your friends aren't Christian people, even if they don't share your worldview, this has to communicate to them, at least on a subliminal level, that because you love them and because you care for them, you want them to experience what you believe to be the unmatched feeling of fulfillment, unparalleled sense of purpose, and unconditional love that you have found through a relationship with Jesus. Just as you would tell everyone you know and love about the amazing experience you had at a restaurant on Las Olas, where the food is delicious and the service was amazing, how much more should you want to tell every single person in your life about the inexpressible, incomparable joy you have found through a relationship with Jesus? 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 1 says that we can speak in the tongues of angels or of men, but if we do not have love, then we are only the sound of a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. My message for you today is this. If our message is not marked by love, then we will miss the mark of our mission. I've heard it said before, and I believe it to be true, that every generation has a sound. Are you aware of this? Every generation has a sound. Do I need to prove it to you? Every generation has a sound. All right, I'm going to prove it. I'm going to get in trouble on my birthday, but that's all right. I wasn't alive during this period of time, but in the 1980s, there was a sound that defined that generation. You're probably familiar with it. It's nothing short of iconic. It sounded something like this. Can the video team help me out? Come on, you can make some noise for Michael Jackson. That's okay. Then the 90s rolled around, and the sound of that generation got a little grungy. Video team. I'm sorry for that. Then the 2000s showed up, and the new millennium came with a new sound, and it has an attitude. I love all these holy Christian people pretending like they've never listened to Eminem before. That's great. And in the 2010s, with the emergence of social media and apps like Instagram and TikTok, with so many different sounds being shared all at once, it can be hard to pinpoint what sound really defined and dominated that generation. But I think we can all agree, for lack of better words, the sound was happy. It might seem crazy what I'm about to say. Sunshine, she's here, you can take a break. every generation has a sound. Now it's only March of 2024. There is more of this decade, of this generation in front of us than behind us. So let me ask you, what will be the sound that defines and dominates this generation? There is always a sound of heaven that is in competition with the sound of this world to be the dominating sound and voice of a generation. And in past generations, the sound of this world has been appealing and accommodating and attractive to behaviors and beliefs that lead people to chasing momentary satisfactions and temporary highs that for sure feel good for a little while, but always, in the end, ultimately leave people feeling hopeless, hurting, and helpless. And only to make matters worse, the sound of heaven that you and I as Christian people have been called and commissioned by King Jesus to carry, that is supposed to be marked by a sound of love and grace and mercy, has not been represented with such a tune. Don't get me wrong, the message of the gospel has always remained the same. That will never change, but the melody has been manipulated. You and I here in South Florida, we live in a modern day Galilee. We live in an area, in a city where God's not the last thing on people's minds. He's not even on their minds. So naturally, the people where we live are going to assume that if there even is a God, he must be like the Christian people who claim to represent him. Please understand, the message of the gospel is not just a truth we are to speak. The message of the gospel is a truth that we must live out. So if you live out a mean gospel, if you live out an angry gospel, if you live out a hateful gospel, a judgmental gospel, a prejudiced gospel, a bigoted gospel, a misogynistic gospel, a political gospel, a racist gospel, then this is what others will believe the gospel is. The word gospel in the original Greek translates into English to mean good news. Good news. Somebody say good news. So if you ask me, in this generation, in my generation, in our generation, we need a sound that clears the confusion. We need a sound that cuts through the noise. We need a sound that carries truth. We need a sound that accurately represents and articulates what the truth of the gospel is. The gospel is not mean. The gospel is not angry. The gospel is not hateful. The gospel is not judgmental. The gospel is not bigoted. The gospel is not prejudiced. The gospel is not racist, political, or misogynistic. But the gospel is full of love. The gospel is full of grace. The gospel is full of mercy. The gospel is full of truth. The gospel is not a story of condemnation. The gospel is a story of salvation. The gospel is a story of a loving shepherd who leaves his flock of 99 behind to chase after the one who is lost. The gospel is a story of a forgiving father who welcomes back home his children who consistently disobey him and reject his love. The gospel is a story of a compassionate creator who, in a selfless act of love, let the comfort and luxury of heaven to save those he created from their own mistakes. I wish somebody would help me preach. The gospel is not bad news. The gospel's not just okay news. The gospel's not just so-so news. The gospel is good news. It's great news. It's amazing news. It's the best news. It's blessed news. Is there anybody who's been saved and forgiven by the hope of the gospel who knows that it's a truth that's too good to keep to ourselves? Make some noise for King Jesus in this church. Let us not forget. Let us not forget what the gospel has done for us. You can take a seat for a moment. I got 5 minutes. It's my birthday. I'm going to make the most of every single one. And if you ask me, what really makes the gospel so great is the terrible punishment that Christ endured in our place. Scripture says, for all have sinned and all fall short of the glory of God, meaning the wages of sin is death. You and I, as sinners, we deserve to be punished. Not only this, but we deserve the most ultimate and final form of punishment that there is. This is scripture. We deserve, according to the Bible, eternal separation from God. We don't deserve God's love. We don't deserve God's mercy. We don't even deserve God's grace. Actually, we've caused God so much pain and so much heartbreak. God has every reason to forsake us, forget all about us, and never forgive us. But instead, this is the beauty of the gospel. This is the truth that is too good to keep to yourselves. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. So that way, if we place our trust and our faith in a relationship with Him, we would be free from the punishment our sin has earned us. And one day when we die, we can spend eternity in heaven with our Creator. So First Baptist Church, I don't know about you, but because Jesus died for me, I'm going to live for Him. Because Jesus redeemed and restored my soul, I'm going to represent Him to the best of my ability. Because Jesus took on the pain of my punishment in my place, I will do everything in my power to preach, proclaim, and praise His name all the days of my life. Our mission is of the utmost importance. Our message is the most significant of all. This is why here at First Baptist Church, we do what we do, and we do it the way that we do it, because the stakes are literally too high to play it safe. They are heaven and hell, life and death, purpose or punishment. This is why we cannot go silently into the night. This is why in a world that wants us to apologize for our beliefs, we cannot. This is why we must do everything and anything short of sin to reach somebody for Jesus. This is why we must become all things to all men so that some may choose to be saved. This is why we gotta be loud. This is why we gotta be bold. This is why we gotta be proud. This is why we gotta shout the truth of the gospel from the rooftops if we have to. For our Savior is Jesus Christ. He is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. He is the Prince of Peace. He is the Good Shepherd. He is the prophesied Messiah. He is the one the veil tore before. He is the one death cannot defeat. He is the one the grave cannot contain. He is God. It's the truth that can change this city, that can change this world, that can change the lives of those we know and love who have not heard it yet. Let me tell you, you have more influence than you know with those that you know. Do not let the enemy talk you into timidity. Be bold. Be courageous. Out of love for those that you know, invite them to join you here for Easter. I promise we're not going to embarrass you. We're not going to make you look weird. But we're going to work hard. We're going to prepare. And we will have an excellent Easter experience for those that you bring with you to worship King Jesus come that Sunday. I also think there are those of you here right now who you've received the truth of the gospel. You've already made Jesus your Lord and Savior. But maybe you haven't gone public with that decision. Maybe you have not yet announced to the world through baptism that Jesus is the Lord of your life. I want you to know something. After this service, we're going to have baptisms. I think my friend Rod is somewhere in the building. I'm baptizing him after this service. I can't wait. There he is. Look, everybody give Rod a round of applause. I'm proud of you, man. I'm proud of you. So some of you need to join Rod after the service to get baptized, but maybe you have friends and family who aren't here right now that you want to be there for that moment. Easter Sunday at sunrise on Pompano Beach, you need to get baptized. It's the first thing that Jesus commands us to do after we give our lives to Him. Let's go ahead and get it done already. Be bold. Be loving. Make invitations that disagree with your comfort, because God is going to use us to change this city. Pray with me. Father, thank you for your love, for your mercy, for your grace, for your forgiveness. God, help us as we leave this place, as we leave here and are obedient to your word. God, we ask, Lord, that you would just give us the courage we need, the strength we need, the faith we need to make invitations that may scare us. And God, we ask right now that you would even begin to prepare the hearts of those we're going to invite. That God, you would just make them extra receptive to our invitations. And that God, when they come and join us here on Easter, their lives would be radically changed for the better, because they're going to give their lives to you. It's in the name of Jesus we pray together. Amen.